Hi there, and welcome back to 365 Data Science. In today's lesson, we'll explore the different types of data architecture and where they can be deployed. We'll cover the three main types of data architecture: centralized, decentralized, and hybrid, advantages and limitations of each architecture type, real-world examples and use cases, deployment options, cloud, on-premises, and hybrid environments, and how to choose the right architecture for your needs. Let's dive in! There are three distinct types of architectures commonly seen across the industry today. They are centralized, decentralized, and hybrid data architectures. Irrespective of which architecture you choose to build, the entire system can be hosted either on-premises in a private environment or on a cloud-based environment. Let's dive deep into each of these concepts individually. But before we get into them, a quick word about today's lesson. If you're finding this introduction to data architecture helpful, you'll love our comprehensive courses at 365datascience.com. We offer in-depth training at data architecture, data engineering, and building data pipelines from scratch. Our step-by-step approach helps you master these crucial skills at your own pace, with hands-on projects and real-world examples. Now let's return to our exploration of architecture types. First up are centralized architectures. Imagine a city that has only one public library, and all possible books for the entire city are stored there. Anyone needing a book from any corner of the city will need to travel to this library to get the information they need, because there are no alternatives. That is centralized data architecture in a nutshell. All data flows into and is stored in one location, usually a data warehouse or a centralized database. All downstream components and systems access data from this singular source. There are some advantages to building a centralized data architecture. It's easier to manage and secure, since everything's in one place. And it's also great for maintaining consistency, since you only have one version of the truth that needs to be written and maintained. Centralized data architectures are common within banks, and especially in the processing of financial transactions. All customer data is stored in a central database to ensure compliance with organizational and state laws, and to accurately associate transactions with the user. The cost of error is very high in financial systems, therefore they tend to maintain one source of truth. While centralized architectures have their advantages, they also come with some limitations. Central data systems can get significantly slow if too many people are accessing it at once. Imagine thousands of readers issuing, reading, and returning books at the same time. It will cause bottlenecks. And since there is one central system, if it goes down, everything comes to a standstill. How do we solve these limitations? We would need an architecture that can withstand failures, so is fault-tolerant and allows for parallel access of data. This is where decentralized architectures come in. To better understand this, think of multiple smaller libraries, each serving a small neighborhood in the city. These libraries manage their own collections and serve local needs, so there is no longer the need to go to one central library for all the information. In the world of data, decentralized architectures are designed to spread data across various systems or geographical locations. These are systems where individual teams or departments within a company are managing their own data sets. Decentralized architectures surely have their advantages. They enable faster performance because data is now stored closer to the users who need it. And most importantly, they avoid bottlenecks on a single system, because all the read and write loads can now be distributed across different instances of the system. A great example of a successful implementation of decentralized architectures was when social media applications like Facebook and X first came out. They were required to store personal user data in compliance with local and state laws, depending on where the user lives. To establish this, they managed data centers in several parts of the world to keep user data in compliance. and parallelly also enabling faster access, as data for a user is always available physically closer to them. But it's still not the perfect solution for all problems. Decentralized systems also pose some challenges, like lack of consistency. If the same data is being stored and updated in several places, it becomes hard to keep it consistent. Imagine a book by an author that's available in all the neighborhood libraries. If an author releases a new version, every library must update their stock. If some libraries stay updated and others don't, people might start going to the up-to-date centers. And secondly, since data is spread across various places, it's also harder to secure access to it, because a singular access point will no longer work. That brings us to a solution that is often considered the best of both worlds. These are hybrid architectures. Imagine those neighborhood libraries being connected to a central system. They manage their own collections, but also send updates to the main library, keeping everyone in sync. This is what hybrid architectures aim to do. They combine centralized and decentralized elements, allowing data to be stored centrally, but also shared and managed locally as and when needed. The hybrid approach, therefore, can solve problems faced by the centralized and decentralized architectures by balancing between performance and consistency, and offering more flexibility in securing and governing data systems. Most modern-day organizations operate on a hybrid architecture. For example, Amazon stores critical data like customer details centrally, but also manages localized data like inventory and delivery routes regionally. Although the hybrid system is the best of both worlds, it's not a work-for-all solution because it is much more complex to design and manage and requires advanced tools and governance practices, making it the costliest of the three options. All right. So now we know that there are three types of architectures that you can choose from when designing a data architecture. But where does a data system get built? To understand that, let's switch gears and talk about where these architectures are built and deployed. There are three options for hosting data architectures: the cloud, on-premises, or a hybrid setup. Let's look at all three. Starting with cloud-native architectures that are built completely on the cloud. Think of them as renting an apartment where you don't have to worry about maintenance or upgrading the building. You only pay a rent and fees for whatever services you use. That's the cloud. In cloud-based architectures, your data lives in remote servers managed by providers like AWS, Azure, Google Cloud, or Oracle Cloud. There are some key advantages to building a cloud-native system. They are highly scalable, meaning you can add storage or computing power as you go, on demand. They come with almost infinite capacities. Plus, the upfront costs are low if you start small. The principle is that you pay for only what you use. And lastly, since these are located around the world, all cloud services are accessible from anywhere in the world with an internet connection. A great example of a cloud-native product is Netflix. Their data architecture runs solely on AWS that has allowed them to scale from 16 million subscribers in 2010 to approximately 282 million subscribers in 2024 without any interruption to their services. Now, if you think about this from an organization's perspective, the unique advantages of cloud-based architectures can very quickly turn into challenges for managing and securing data. That's because cloud systems rely on active internet connectivity, which introduces an external dependency on the company's data architecture. What happens if the internet goes out? Although highly unlikely, this is still a risk. And since most components of the architecture physically live with the cloud provider, there is a risk of data breaches. We'll talk in more detail about cloud-based data options in a future lesson, but for now, let's see if an on-premises architecture can solve the challenges of a cloud-based architecture. You can think of on-premises architectures as owning a house. You have full control of how it looks and what it contains, but you also have the responsibilities of maintaining it. On-premises architectures involve hosting data on your own servers within your organization. They do address some concerns, like on-premises systems give you the full control of your data and infrastructure, so there is no question about data security. In situations where certain local governments or regulations require data to be stored locally, a server inside your organization is the best way to adhere to those regulations. Most banks and healthcare organizations often use on-premises systems to meet these strict regulatory requirements and keep personal information about their clients in-house. Although more secure, on-premises systems come with their own challenges. To build a data center of your own, there are high upfront costs for hardware and maintenance involved. Scalability can be limited compared to the cloud, meaning if you initially set up a data center of 5,000 server racks and in 10 years want to upgrade it to host 50,000 server racks, it will be nearly impossible without building a completely new data center. So, which architecture is the best? Well, it depends. Centralized systems are great for consistency, decentralized ones for speed, and hybrids for balance. Similarly, cloud-based systems shine when you need scalability, while on-premises work well for control. The key is aligning your choice with your organization's goals. And remember, there's no one-size-fits-all. It's all about what works for your needs. Now let's recap the key points we've covered in this lesson. We explored three main types of data architecture: centralized, decentralized, and hybrid. Each architecture type has its own advantages and limitations. We discussed real-world applications and use cases for each type. We covered deployment options including cloud, on-premises, and hybrid environments. And finally, we learned how to choose the right architecture based on specific requirements. Well, thank you for watching this video on data architecture types. If you found this information helpful, remember to check out our full courses at 365datascience.com for more in-depth content on data architecture and related topics. And until next time, keep learning!